This video is about my design process and how I go about designing and prototyping a product. In this case, how we modify an existing Tree Electrojet air marker to accept current modern day markers so you can use them to do your marker renderings with. My name's Eric Strebel. I'm an industrial designer. If you're new to my channel, I hope that you subscribe and check out some of the other design and making videos that I have. Such as this ultra quiet shop compressor so that I can have some air to do my marker renderings with. I start the project with a little design sketch. It's a side view. It shows me how it's going to hold the marker and how it's going to adapt to the existing air marker body. Next in CAD, I need to model up a simple clasp or a section of this body to see how it's going to actually hold the marker in place, how well it's going to snap onto the existing air marker. Here's an example of all the little prototypes that I did. Here you can see me snapping on and testing how well the grip is for the different kind of markers. Some are too loose, some are too tight. Thus, I have a series of prototypes and stages that I go through where I'm trying out different ideas to solve the problem. Ultimately, I get a good fit and I figure out how things are going to work. Next, I'm going to need to remove the existing holder for the old Tree Electrojet system, and that's going to get cut away. Now back to CAD, where we're going to actually model this thing based on the section that was successful before so that we can rapid prototype it and cast it and make a functioning part. Here's a quick rendering of what the part should look like. We send it to the 3D printer to be printed up. Here's what it looks like next to and in reference to the existing air marker. It holds a Prismacolor very well. It's going to snap onto a Copic marker too. So this is what I would call a low-level prototype. It's kind of rough, needs some cleanup, and it needs a little bit of work still. So we take it over to the mill, and I'm going to mill out some additional material. Something that was just too big of a pain or too much guesswork involved in CAD because we're adapting it to something. So I'm going to machine it out, give me the clearance for the lever to move up and down. Here you can see I'm cutting off the old Tree Electrojet holder on the air marker itself. And I put the two together and you get a pretty good idea of what it is we're going to go for. Here I'm snapping it onto a piece of wood because I'm going to start to prime it so I can get all the print lines out of the part. I'm always using a sanding block when I sand the primer. Always, always, always use a sanding block to get good surfacing. Here's the finished primed part that we're going to cast. This is my molding box. I add some clay and I'm going to lay this up in the box. We're going to make a simple two-part mold. Place the part into the casting box. There's a fake floor that's removable. I'm adding some guide holes, and here I'm adding some guide blocks so that the two pieces of silicone, the part A and the part B of the mold, can attach together securely repeatedly over time. I add a little bit of release agent there just to the bottom where I'm going to remove that later. Mixing up some silicone here. Mix it well. It's getting degassed. I take the bubbles out of it so that way I can pressure cast it without getting the measles. You can check out some of my other casting videos that go into much more detail about how two-part silicone molds are made. After the silicone setup, I remove the bottom, I remove the little fake floor, it gives me some space. I want to keep the part in the silicone so that I can pour the other part B on top. I add a little bit of release agent because it's silicone against silicone, normally I wouldn't. So I'm mixing up the silicone for the other half of the mold and I add a little colorant to it as well. some toner to just to separate, just to differentiate the two silicone halves so that they're not exactly the same. I degassed the silicone as well, and then I'm gonna pour it on top, first inside the part, and then to make the rest of the mold. The little stick that's sticking up there, that's gonna be my pour hole when I pour the resin into the part. Here I'm demolding the two halves. I need to take the master out of the silicone mold, and I punch in two little air vents, something that I kind of forgot to do on the silicone mold. And here I'm mixing up some resin, again degassing the resin. It's essential to degas the resin so you don't get bubbles in your part. You get a nice strong uniform piece. After the part's been injection casted, it goes in the pressure tank, and here's being removed from the silicone mold. I'm taking it out. There's a little bit of flash in there, but that's super easy to clean up. It doesn't take much to remove that and get a nice part. I need to clean up the little sprue area or the injection port. I do that with a knife so that it can seat onto the existing air marker. It snaps right on. There you go. Ready to use. So that's the standard sort of design and prototyping process that I would go through for any product that I was designing for a client. I realize it's an awful lot of work just for a one-of knockoff personal product. But it makes a good solid piece. It's gonna last a long time, and it's also a great way to show the design process. Check out the link at the end of the video and you can actually see me doing an air marker demo. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. You can click on the little icon on the bottom right of the screen to do that. You can follow me on Twitter, Facebook, and Google+. Rock on.